bit of background into what our project's for. So the biology department has comprised a team to study plants and how they've been affected by climate change. Particularly what they're studying is temperature and light changes to these plants. For this, they have made an 18-week study during the summer in northern Alaska to do so. As you can see in the picture, we're setting up a tripod with a whole bunch of different instruments to collect data for this study. So throughout our presentation, we're going to be using unfamiliar terminology. This mostly comprises of light. The first of which is PAR, photosynthetically active radiation. And this is light between 400 and 700 nanometers. As you can see from the graph, that's essentially what we as people can see light. Plants are a bit more sensitive to this, so it's very important to make sure that we're working within this range. Another is PFD, photon flux density. And this is how many photons of a single wavelength there are. Think of it almost as rain. Count how many raindrops hit the ground every second. We're doing the same thing, only for light photons. The last is PPFD, photosynthetic photon flux density. Now this is just the sum of photons within that PAR range. Now both of these use a pretty niche unit, micromoles per meter squared per second. So the biology department team went in to recreate those environments that they studied here at Wilkes University. In order to do so, they leased out environmental control chambers to do that. Now this was done primarily for two reasons. The first of which is that 18-week cycle. That's a long time to wait an entire year to study again. Being able to run that experiment over and over helps drastically. Another reason is to control the variables. Through the chambers, they'll be able to control the temperature, the humidity, and the light. And while they were conducting their study, they ran into an issue. They were not able to control a specific part. And this part is the red to far red ratio. Now this is essential for the plants and what they're studying.
So currently in those test chambers, there are seven working LEDs right now. Each LED has 112 components within the test chambers. I mean, in total, there are 784 LEDs. Again, like Ben had mentioned, when the biology team wants to input, say, go from 1% to 2% in their system, all 112 LEDs simultaneously turn from 1% to 2% of power, which then creates that invariable range and the imprecision and inaccurate data results that they are getting. And like Ben had said, the chambers are being leased out, so we're not able to change any of the software or the hardware in the chamber. So for that, our senior project must not obstruct any of the current lights with, that are working properly, as well as not emit unwanted PFD into the system.
So with all that being said, we decided to break our project down into five main categories. These categories include the physical design, which includes the design of the framework, and the electronics we plan on using. The Arduino coding, which is how we will control these LEDs that we place inside the chamber, the construction of the frame, the assembly of all the components, and then later the testing of our LEDs, our sensor feedback, and the overall stability and robustness of our system.
For our mechanical requirements for our project, the LEDs are centrally located within the chamber, so we want to make sure that we are not obstructing them. So we're going to position our supplemental light structure on the outsides of the chamber while still being able to project the LEDs towards the center and create an equal distribution of those LEDs, of the red and the infrared LEDs of those wavelengths. We also want to make it mobile, lightweight, just that it's easy for the user to put to put into the chamber as well as take out of it. And we also want to make it adjustable so that it is used for other different uses. So the biology department is also doing hemp plants. These chambers are longer and smaller, so being able to have an adjustable structure for us would be a big help for them, as well as their LEDs. They can use it to snap in different colors if they want, and make it adjustable in the length and both directions.
So like we said before, the biology department is having trouble with this red infrared ratio, but they are pretty successful with everything else within the chamber. So what we plan on doing is adding a supplemental structure that has additional red and infrared LEDs to help balance and create this ideal ratio that they're trying to get. So, like Andrew said, we want to get this structure up and out of the way of the current LEDs. That's why we designed it in such a way that it's hollow on the inside. These LEDs are located centrally inside the chamber. So to get up and out of the way is ideal so we don't obstruct and harm their experiment in any way. We plan on welding certain pieces of this frame. Right here, where you see this seam, we're going to weld the two extruded parts and the leg, as well as down here. So because of that, we plan on using steel. Steel's relatively easy to weld. It's easy to get our hands on, and it's relatively budget-friendly. Also, we plan on using some sort of coating on this steel frame, just so we can prevent rusting and increase the longevity of our system. Also, like Andrew said, we want this to be very versatile. We want to be able to change the X, Y, and Z dimensions of our system. So for that reason, we're going to use a series of holes and pins to mount and to set in place our dimensions that we want based on the chamber that is being used. As you can see, it's used on the legs, but it is also used on the cross members on the top and bottom. And here's just two of the extreme cases. As you can see here, this is the expanded version. It's about 44 inches tall by 36 and a half by 36 and a half inches. And for our condensed version, it's about 30 inches tall by 24 and a half by 24 and a half.
So because we want to mount these LED clips to the hang lines that Caleb said that we were welding onto our machine, we want to fasten them, we believe that Velcro is the best option, or at least our first choice option. We don't want to introduce any double-sided tape or hot glue just in case you might harm the structures or anything inside the chambers right now with the current tests that they're doing. We think that's going to Velcro is going to be the best option. Ideally, the picture on the right showcases a green 3D printed clip for the LED. This will then be put onto the structure in the next slide. So seen on the right hand picture is a view of those LED clips fastened to the structure with their projection coming down towards the middle. So this will then be able to be used with those red and those infrared LEDs. So we realize that we are all three of us are mechanical engineers, so the electrical side will be one of our focuses for the next semester. However, we want to be able to power and source our LEDs with the correct voltage and currents at all times. If we need a power adjustment, we want to be able to do that safely. We also want to code the apogee red infrared sensor, which is seen on the right-hand picture. We want to be able to code a feedback system, so this will be able to correct any of the infrared red and infrared ratio that they might need for our system, as well as we also want to make sure that our LEDs are not compromised by any condensation or humidity that might occur within the system. Currently, the environmental test chambers can reach a temperature of negative 10 degrees Celsius, and during that, the biology team does like a reset, so this will essentially purge the system of those floor temperatures for 10 minutes. We just want to make sure that no water compromises our system.
And so like Andrew said, we do plan on controlling these LEDs, and the way that we plan on doing this is through the use of an LED matrix. What this basically is an arrangement of LEDs in rows and columns where rows share common anodes and columns share common cathodes. We have proven this concept to work, as you can see in the bottom corner. Unfortunately, we are not able to control prime number of LEDs when we use an LED matrix. So to solve this problem, we plan on adding one additional LED outside of the matrix that we can call on to if we need, say, a prime number of LEDs.
So how exactly do we know how many LEDs that we need to introduce into the system? So for this, we need to make sure that we're adding the proper amount of PFD level. And when you buy lights, they don't exactly on the box tell you how many photons a light creates. So for this, we'll be conducting a study. Now this is the same study that light fixtures companies perform. What it does is it counts how many photons are in each of those individual squares. This is a picture actually from a light distribution company. Now for us, we'll be testing the red and the infrared LEDs, and we'll be using the exact same instruments that the biology team used in Alaska and with their current studies to make sure we're doing accurate and necessary changes. So we'll be studying the distance, how high the LEDs actually need to be, along with the width and length, obviously, if we're dealing with a rectangle. the angle. We need to make sure that we're angling the LEDs to make sure we have an even coating. We don't want to make sure that one plant receives more light than the others. The intensity. We want to make sure that we're feeding enough electrical current that we're happy and we can control those LEDs properly, as well as the combination of the two. Since we're dealing with LEDs, they mostly focus on just a particular wavelength, but we don't live in an ideal world. So we want to make sure that we're dealing with just those, and we want to make sure that there is no overlap. And through that, we can also determine by looking at the PPFD levels if we're adding any unwanted wavelengths. So that way we can eliminate any unnecessary bits during our study. Now for ethics, we mentioned previously that we need to treat our metal as well as our exposed electronic components. We want to make sure that if we're using any of those chemicals, they are unharmful to ourselves, the test chamber, as well as the plants. We do not want to compromise the experiment.
Seen here is our table for our proposed budget for the fall and the spring semesters. Currently right now, we have bought two LEDs, one red and one infrared. We'll be doing preliminary tests with them just to kind of gauge how many we may need to initially purchase to control the PFD levels that we might need. As well as we've also quoted the LED spray that we might need to essentially waterproof those LEDs within the chamber. This brings our total to around $40. That leaves us enough capital to purchase any of the other metals and the other electronic components that we might need to purchase going forward.
So seen here is just a figure that provides you with a schedule of what we've done thus far and we're still continuing to do. So you can see most of our time has been taken up by researching our LEDs. We spent a lot of time doing this. We met with Dr. Marcel and Dr. Fletcher, where they really helped us iron out what exactly they needed from us, what they were having trouble with, and what we needed to control, which then led to a meeting that we had with Dr. Zhu, where we landed on the idea of the LED matrix as our method for controlling our LEDs. And that has led us to now where we are currently in the testing phase of these LEDs, so we can determine how many we might need going forward in the future for our final product.
So our proposed plan for the spring semester would be able to assemble metal structure, as well as being able to put our LEDs on to the structure. We also want to be able to test and make sure that our feedback sensor works accordingly, as well as being able to self-correct that within our program. And as a final end goal, we also want to be able to create a human-machine interface that goes on alongside the outside of the environmental test chamber, so that it's easy for the biology team to input their set red and infrared ratios along with the other LED lights that they need. Listed here are our references that we've used.
And we would like to thank Dr. Anaya for being our advisor and giving us help. We'd like to also thank Dr. Fetcher and Dr. Marcel for helping us better understand exactly what we're dealing with. And we would also like to thank Ms. Suzanne Stash for helping us order these parts for our study.
Thank you. We'd like to
and I don't know the answer to that.
Sure.
Just suggestion. sensor that the two LEDs that you pick are all red, and the grid can pick them up.
So that's the sensor. Those are the particular wavelengths the sensor reads, and those correspond to the same wavelengths that the test chamber outputs as well. So we're focusing on those two wavelengths.
And I'm guessing you put the sensor probably on the top of the plant, or at least near that, because
yes,
you know what the type rings do in terms of contacting. And then are you putting the feedback from there and pair it? Is that how you control the density?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
What's the output of this OT sensor?
So the output of this sensor depends on how much light it receives. It's a voltage, yes.
Are you sure it's a voltage?
Yes.
It's an analog signal, it's a voltage.
Yes.
So this sensor directly give you the red to infrared ratio? Is that like this voltage is exactly what you need? Is that true?
So the sensor has two separate outputs. It has one that corresponds to the red and one that corresponds to the far red. And those two give you those measurements.
Based on those two numbers, you can calculate your red infrared ratio.
Exactly.
So that's the number you're trying to control.
Yes.
So does it give two different signals then? So are they two systems of comparators? Because is it giving you one voltage output or is it giving you two? Because it'd be hard to distinguish the tone of the red and increase infrared. But if it gives you just one voltage, you don't know which is which.
Well, I'm not quite sure. I have to look into it more. It gives us two voltages. But due to the fact that these two wavelengths don't really affect PAR a whole lot, we don't exactly need to know how much of each it is as long as we have that ratio, because adding a bunch of red doesn't affect PAR a whole lot, so it doesn't, the amount of input that we put into the system is not going to affect the rest of it. So whatever it gives us, we can still use to fine tune that ratio. We don't necessarily need to know the exact amounts of each, it's just that number that we're really worried about.
If you want
to
fine tune it for certain flora, if you wanted more red, less infrared, based on what you're studying.
Yeah.
And if it's giving you one signal, you can't determine how to control either or. Because I'm guessing you'll have two different switches, one for infrared and one for red.
Yeah, we have two different separate LED matrices.
Yeah, so if you have one feedback with two different systems, you're not going to be able to fine tune either or. It's either they both go up or they both go down. You're not having that fine tuned level either.
So the ratio will determine that. So the ratio at one means that they're both equal. If the ratio is higher than one, there's more red output than there's far red. If it's under one, there's more far red output. So that way we can measure and compare with the data that we collected in Alaska to reach those desired measurements.
Okay, I want to get this clear. So it's a closed loop feedback control system,
yes.
Right? That is, so how do you punch the number in, like your target? How do you punch it in?
We haven't exactly started. But
you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Like, is that just one number or two numbers?
It should be just one.
It should be based on the information of the sensor.
Like, how would you specify? Like, do you specify one number or two numbers?
We specify just the ratio, and then we receive these the data from the
sensor. If you just specify the ratio, then you have so many combinations, which one do you use? Because 1 over 2 equals 2 over 4, and the 3 over 6, you see?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's something to look into going forward.
Yeah, so you need to figure out what part you're punching, and also it's going to be a close to feedback of the structure.
Just another answer. Just a suggestion, you have too many holes to do what you're trying to accomplish.
Yeah.
You don't need them in both directions, and you don't need them in the telescoping and the receiving point. I would say just one hole on the outer one, and then you could have the inner to do.
That was